I'm going to talk about my students and about how I design for my students. I'm really lucky in that I get to make a LARP for students I have known for 4 years. It's a bit of a special circumstance that you don't usually get as a LARP writer, but I was lucky. Still, they were forced. I didn't explicitly force them, but path lesson, you come here, I didn't give them a choice really to not attend. I said they could, more or less, but they joined. The school where I work is called Lindeberg. It's right next to here. And we are now at the east side of Oslo. This is called Groruddalen. It's a big, it's a cheap housing part of Oslo. A lot of the, how do I say this in a sensitive way? It is
underprivileged.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, oops. I will tell you more concrete details about that later. Let's see. And I teach science and maths, and I also have a really, really nice principal that allows me to teach other subjects sometimes. But my education is in science and maths. I'm, let's say, a spawn of the summer school. I hadn't actually LARPed anything until 3 years ago when I joined a black box LARP that Martin and some others arranged. So a lot of my methods are from there, and my perspective is from there. And I'm, relatively new. I also have run some LARPs with my students. One real LARP called The Village, a Swedish LARP. And I run some, what do you say, not properly LARPs, but I tell stories and use students as props. I think it has a name, but I'm not sure. So they're used to some craziness. This is a picture of a random selection from the year group. Some of them are in my class. I know most of them. I had them for a lot of years. They're so grown up. They were 12 when I first had them. Now they're 16, a lot of them. You can see the diversity. Really nice kids. But of course, there are challenges. Some are restless. Some have weak language abilities. I'll get back to that. So, there are 25 in my group. Some have done some theater, but most not. Some of them, like Matthias, who will talk later, has done some theater in the local youth club or something. Yeah, more or less. And the group is a bit special because they have a high level of internal trust. Matthias will talk more about that later. But some of the other classes, people are more insecure there. They wouldn't dare raise their voices and say something if they were afraid it was stupid. But in that group, it's a bit better. I have this scientific questionnaire later, so you'll see for yourself. Yes. But teenagers are teenagers, and you could say that they are fundamentally insecure. It's hard to be a teenager. So you have to design for that. And even though the group as a whole more or less trust each other, there are, of course, or sadly, others that don't feel the same way. It doesn't make sense to speak of 25 people as a group and say that they trust each other. Also, you have the language abilities. We'll see that as well. Some of them aren't that good at expressing themselves, and that makes the insecurity even more severe and limiting. So I had to design for that. Yes. And that, of course, makes it hard to improvise. This is my scientific analysis of my students. The questions are really, really weird, mainly because I made them up like 15 minutes before the lesson. Because I remembered that I had forgotten to do a proper evaluation. So this is done like 2 months after the LARP, bear in mind. There are a lot of questions. These are only some of them. And you have those who disagree, those who are indifferent, and those who agree. It's a 5-point scale. So the red is those that strongly disagree or disagree. Those are the indifferent. And these are those who agree or strongly disagree. I strongly agree. So you see, in this group, a lot of them trust that the others won't look down on them if they do something stupid, which is good. If it's true, I don't know. That's a problem about questionnaires. It was anonymous, but still people fill out often as they feel they should, or as they want to please me and be nice to me. I always keep this in mind. I'm usually a bit insecure about myself. Half of them have said, no, that's not true. I don't believe them at all. And half of them have said they are indifferent or they agree they're insecure. And that's pretty strong to be 15 years old and tick that box. That might be a hard moment of reflection for a lot of them. A lot of these questions are like that. I made it volunteer to answer the questionnaire. Of course, they do it anyway because I'm the teacher. But in principle, it's those voluntarily. I usually think it's hard to express myself orally. Also, hard box to tick. A lot did. I usually think it's hard to know where to keep my hands. This is another way of asking the same question. And a lot of them tick that box. It's hard. When you're doing theater, what should you do? Hands in pockets. It's a sign of daily insecurity, maybe not. Also, I had this 5-point scale and I wanted to know the gender. So that's, That's for all you Swedes out there. I did a non-binary scale. And as you see, they are very binary.
That's okay.
Actually, a few of them ticked on a 2 or on a 4. And I explained beforehand in a, might be offensive way. I explained what it means to be a 4 or a 3 on the scale. And I used myself as an example. I said, I don't feel like a girl, I'm a boy. But I don't necessarily enjoy typical, stereotypical boy things. I don't enjoy football, and I care about people. So, yeah. But anyway, so this is my group. And this is the LARP I made for them. This is the end result. They had roles, which were numbers. It was more or less like a math version of Paradise Hotel, in that they made alliances and backstabbed each other. And they had to decide which numbers get to stay on the number line. And they could make alliances as they wanted. And I gave points based on their defense speeches. Some of you are playing this LARP now. And it's really, really unfair, of course, how I give points. It's part of the comedy. And the unworthy numbers that doesn't get enough points get thrown out. It's pretty harsh, really. But I think most of them get that my rating system is totally unfair. It's pure random silliness. So, yeah. So for this group, there are a lot of things to consider. My main goal, apart from the maths curriculum thing that I tell my principal, is that everyone should feel comfortable playing their roles, even though they are language weak, insecure teenagers. That's not necessarily easy. And they should feel involved in the LARP, even though they don't actually take any initiative or do anything. A lot of my students never open their mouth. Many of them don't actually open their mouth. I think it was 2 years before I heard some of their voices. Or I can't remember their voice if I'm trying. It's a bit sad, of course, but a LARP might be a horrible experience if I put the spotlight on them and say, talk, defend your number. Of course, I can't do that. But I need them to feel that they are a part of it, even though they don't directly contribute to the play. And that is possible. And we'll see how. So I'm basing this presentation, the rest of it, on a number of insecurities that I know my students have or expect them to have. And there are 6 insecurities. Some of them are, of course, overlapping. One is insecurity about the situation in general. Do something you haven't done before. It's super scary. And they're teenagers, of course. So, to make this a bit easier, of course, it helps that I do it in a room they are familiar with. I do it at the school. It's their classroom. Also, I like to do a warm-up exercise that they know. As the teachers, I have games we usually play, and I can do one of those, so they feel a bit more at home. If I would run this on other students, I might ask the teacher to do that part. Is there a 7-minute game you can do with them that they know? Just anything to get comfortable in the room. We did a really short version of that. Yes. Make them physically comfortable in the room. Another solution to this is to have full transparency. That means there are no surprises. I explain everything that's going to happen in the play. Sit them down, I tell them what the first round, you're going to do this and this and this, and I'm coming in and do this. And when we all do this, the LARP is finished. So it's predictable. Surprises can be cool, of course, but it can be scary if you've never done it before. So this is the first insecurity, when they enter the room. Make them feel safe and secure. Second, they have absolutely no experience of talking numbers, because numbers don't usually talk. For some of them, numbers move around a lot when they try to do calculations, but they don't actually talk. So it's really abstract, this play in particular. So they have to get a sense of what it means to play this role. So therefore, we practice. That is, they make their roles and they practice saying what their number does. And they practice walking around as a number, practice talking like the number, instructed practice that I do with them before the LARP starts, so that they can try it out themselves. That was number 2. Number 3, where should I keep my hands? This is part of the insecurity thing. When you stand there in the schoolyards, you have 15 minutes break and you have no friends. What do you do? It's really sad to see. So they don't like being alone and different. And this is a LARP about backstabbing and alliances and pushing someone out of the group. So it's horrible to do with teenagers. So I pair them up. I have 25 students, I have like 13 roles. Maybe one of them want to play alone, then I ask them first time. number 13, played alone in my group. He was the joker. And he was a student that he could take it. You might need some help from the teacher doing this. I just did it randomly. I made the rolls, which were just sheets of paper with a number on it. And I tossed it on the floor, and they just got one. Randomly, if they wanted to cheat and get the same number as someone else, they could do that. But it was basically random. And in that group, they have some safety. And even though some of them are really shy and don't want to talk at all, the odds of having two of those in the same pair is really low. So when we do the presentation round, present your numbers, probably one in the pair can take, can say something without it being too horrible for them. If I see that, oh, those two shouldn't be a pair, I can just mix it up. You might need a teacher's help to do those things. So, of course, if you are going to run a LARP with students, it's good to have the teacher there. Yeah. Of course, I forgot to mention, this is about teenagers. A lot of you have professions where you do this with grown-ups, but some of the principles, I guess, applies to them as well. People are insecure, even though they're grown-ups. Yeah. Insecurity number 4. I didn't quite get it. That happens. If you know teenagers or anyone, they don't usually get what you're saying. Some of them are actually bad listeners. Some of them don't know what you're talking about. You give an instruction and they forget it. If you're a teacher, you know what I'm talking about. Or a parent, I guess. Then comes the pairing solution again. One of them might understand what you're saying and remember, and they can instruct each other. Some of them are notoriously bad at listening and following instructions, but hopefully you don't get two of them in the same pair. That happens, of course. Yes. Other solution, give clear instructions. And if you're used to talking to grown-ups, you usually don't know what clear instruction means. Because teenagers need it extremely clear, especially since a lot of them, my students, don't actually know Norwegian that well. They might sound like they know Norwegian, a lot of them, but they know how to say the sentences they usually say. It's like walking through a forest. They can walk on the path, say things they usually say. But when you go out of that path, they stumble because they don't have a sound full vocabulary. And they get confused by some words, and then they can drop out. So super clear instructions. It's useful. Fifth insecurity. Am I actually a part of this? Some of them have really hard time improvising because of personality and language and insecurity in general, as we talked about. That is why I grouped them up. I paired them up. That helps. But I also group them up. The first defense speech is the odd numbers against the
even
numbers. Yeah. So they don't have to stand there alone. They are part of one of the groups. And even though some of them doesn't say anything, they are still part of that group. So we, the prime numbers, if that's their group, we won the first round. You're a part of something. Or the, if it's the even numbers, maybe you lost, but I always give points to everyone the first round. So they get the point somehow, even though they actually didn't contribute. They might not even notice that they didn't contribute. So this is number 5. Number 6, teacher expectation. Teachers or students, they want to please me. I say you don't have to join this LARP, and they do anyway, because they don't want to be outside. I say, yeah. So this might limit how they play. They might not be able to do real role playing because they want to know what I expect. We just had about numbers in the maths lesson. What am I supposed to improvise? It has to be something in the curriculum. I might get grades for this. So I tend to leave them alone. When they make alliances, I leave the room completely. That might be not dangerous. I stand outside the door and listen, so I'm there. But they feel a bit more free to improvise them. Also, I tell them to feel free. They don't believe me, of course, but tell them this is not about grading. Forget that this is about improvising and having fun. They might believe you, if you're lucky. So this is the thing I took into consideration when I made this LARP. This is how they felt about it. First, there are some negatively phrased questions. There are some bit more positively afterwards. I might have expected that my expectation about them meant like nothing to most of them. I guess that's a student thing. That's good to know. A lot of them also said they didn't feel stupid and insecure in the LARP. This is not in general, this is about the LARP. Less of them felt insecure in the LARP than they do usually, if you remember the previous results. Some of them felt a bit alone. Most didn't. And a lot of them felt it was scary in the beginning. I would expect that. Of course, is this good result? Are there bad results? Of course, the ones who had the bad experience, it's heart-wrecking. Yes, I love these kids, all of them. And I'm not satisfied by anyone not having a good time, of course. So I don't consider this especially good results. It's hard to do a LARP with teenagers. Also here, I had fun. Most of them did to agree. One of them didn't. That's sad. Learned something about numbers. A lot of them did. Some didn't. Understood what to do. Most did. Super clear instructions. They helped each other. I felt that I played my role there. Some felt safe to do things. Are there to take initiative? About half agreed. So a lot of them didn't feel that they actually could do things. But if you see the last one and the first one, a lot of them had fun even though they didn't actually dare do things so much. So, conclusions from this is insecurity is a really big part of the life of the teenagers, as you would expect. Edu-larp design and the running of LARPs need to take this very seriously. So they should, of course, because you want them to learn things and have fun, but also because they all are vulnerable. And if you put them in a really difficult situation, it can be mean to them. And you don't want to do that. And teenagers are awesome LARPers. It was really, really fun. Yes. Thank you.